Okay.
Yeah.
Mahima.
Namaste and good evening. I, Mahima Kapoor, researcher at IMPRI, Impact and Policy Research Institute, Prabhav Evam Niti Anusandhan Sansthan, Nai Delhi, welcome you all to the IMPRI hashtag web policy talk. Today, we have gathered for a special discussion remembering Dr. Gail Omvedt, taking a perspective of land, caste, class, and gender to the global audience under hashtag In Memoriam. This discussion is being organized by the IMPRI Center for Human Dignity and Development. Dr. Gail Omvedt was an American-born Indian sociologist and human rights activist. Ma'am was involved in Dalit and anti-caste movements, environmental, farmers, and women's movements, especially with rural women. Her dissertation was titled Cultural Revolt in a Colonial Society, the Non-Brahmin Movement in Western India, 1873 to 1930. Ma'am was a prolific writer, and her academic writings include numerous books and articles on class, caste, and gender issues. We Will Smash This Prison, Indian Women in Struggle, 1979, Violence Against Women, New Movements and New Theories in India, 1991, Reinventing Revolution, New Social Movements in India, 1993, Gender and Technology, Emerging Asian Visions with Govind Kelkar, 1994, Dalits and the Democratic Revolution, Dr. Ambedkar and the Dalit Movement in Colonial India, 1994. Dalit Visions, the Anti-Caste Movement and Indian Cultural Identity, 1995, among others. Besides undertaking many research projects, she was a consultant for FAO, UNDP, and NOPIP, and served as the Dr. Ambedkar Chair Professor at Niswas, Odisha, a professor of sociology at the University of Pune, and an Asian guest professor at the Nordic Institute of Asian Studies, Copenhagen. She was a senior fellow at the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library and research director of the Krantivir Trust. Ma'am's contribution to academics and activism is immense and will continue to pave the way for revolution. I'm honored to introduce the moderator for this session, Professor Vibhuti Patel. Ma'am is an eminent gender economist and feminist and former professor at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. We are fortunate to have been joined by Dr. Bharat Patankar. Sir is leading activist, Shramik Mukti Dal, Peasant Movement, South Maharashtra, and architect, Equitable Water Distribution Movement, Maharashtra. We extend our deepest condolences to you, sir. I feel privileged to introduce the eminent panel. Professor Manisha Desai is the department head, sociology and professor of sociology and Asian and Asian American studies at University of Connecticut, USA. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you.
Professor Surinder Singh Jodhka is a professor of sociology at Center for the Study of Social Systems, Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. Welcome, sir. Professor Arvind A. Ansari is a professor, Department of Sociology, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, Mahima.
Professor R. Indra is a scholar in residence, Center for Women's Studies, Bangalore University, Bengaluru, and she is former professor of sociology, University of Mysore, Mysuru. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you.
Dr. Ajay Gudavarti is an associate professor, Center for Political Studies, Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
Dr. Uma Kant is an independent scholar based in New Delhi. Welcome, sir. Now, I invite Professor Patel to take the proceedings further, and we look forward to an enlightening discussion. Thank you.
Vibhuti ma'am, unmute. Vibhuti ma'am, unmute us. Yeah, please.
Thank you very much, Mahima, for your introductory welcome address. And now I would like to thank Dr. Arjun Kumar for making great effort to organize today's memorial meeting, remembering Dr. Gail Omvedt and taking a perspective of land, caste, class, gender to global audience. And all my fellow panelists, Dr. Bharat Patankar, Professor Manisha Desai, Professor Surinder, Jodhka, Professor Arvindar Ansari, Professor R. Indira, Professor Ajay Gudavarthi, and Dr. Umakant. Thank you all for at such a short notice of 2 days, all of you have assembled here, and also the participants, such a huge response that we have got for today's meeting. First of all, the IMPRI team has provided this platform to reflect on our collective memories of Gail's work as a theorist, philosopher, sociologist, feminist activist, translator, political revolutionary, and a trusted comrade. And I think trusted comrade, I would like to repeat. Over past 1 week, innumerable memorial meetings have been organized, obituaries and tributes have been published in English, Marathi, Hindi, Gujarati, Tamil, several other regional languages, with great affection, respect, fond memories, and praise for her intellectual rigor and robust scholarship. In the same way, today we are meeting here for remembering Gail Omvedt, with a special focus on how did she took the perspectives of the interplay of land, caste, class, and gender to the global audience. Gail Omvedt, over the past 50 years, has highlighted critical concerns of rural, tribal, and Dalit Bahujan subaltern masses in India. For 5 decades, she made path-breaking and revolutionary contributions by creatively taking ahead Phule, Shahu, Ambedkar perspective of exposing caste-based exploitation and exposing complex interplay of caste, class, gender to reproduce the oppressive social order. As a feminist, I found Gail's commitment astounding. During 70s, 80s, and 90s, we really were closely worked together, traveled together, shared so many common platforms, and also attended several conferences, seminars, and conventions together. Her evidence-based, insightful contributions based on ethnographic methodologies and field-based surveys on deserted women-headed household, deserted women, women-headed household, land rights of rural women, exploitation of working-class women, violence against women by extensive traveling in the most neglected parts of rural and tribal hinterlands under the extremely harsh circumstances touched both heads and hearts of hundreds of social activists. Gail led a Spartan life, never complained about physical discomfort, even while traveling long distance in overcrowded state transport and unreserved compartments of Indian railways. That is a common journey we have had for nearly 20 years from 1970 to 1990. So she exercised great self-discipline, never missed her deadline. She always was moving from one project to project because she did not have a cushy academic job. She survived through her writings. For the submission of her papers, minutes of the conferences of social movement or statement, oration, whatever she promised, she delivered on time. Gail was an accessible and grounded public intellectual, strongly grounded philosopher. She reached out to 4 generations of social scientists and social activists. Her ideas traveled with her. 25 authored books written in a lucid style, and her physical presence in her study circles, shibirs, camp of the youth organization, seminars, conferences, conventions, and gatherings of social movement made her a very, very endearing person, a persona, and a comrade, trusted comrade to thousands of social activists. The most path-breaking contribution of Gail, so far as the women's rights movement is concerned, We Will Smash This Prison, Indian Women in Struggle, which brought her close to, first of all, women's rights movement, and later on to women's studies movement. Her books in colonial society, non-Brahmin movement in Western India, Buddhism in India, Understanding Caste, Dalit Democratic Revolution, New Social Movements are included in the syllabi of social sciences courses in the University cities in India and abroad, seeking Begumpura Prof's dreams, visions of classless, casteless, caring and egalitarian society of Bhakti poets such as Ravidas, Kabir, Chokimela, Janabai, Tukaram and Kartabanjas, and social reformers of the 19th century such as Jyotiba Phule, Ayothi Das, Pandita Ramabai, Periyar, and Ambedkar. We were told about her most path-breaking 15 books, which are making currently their PDF of all these 15 books have been shared extensively by the young scholars on social media, on WhatsApp and email. And there is a lot of intellectual curiosity about the work that she has done. She has mentored hundreds of Dalit, OBC, tribal, Bahujan students as a head of Phule Ambedkar Chair in Savitribai Phule, Pune University, as a professor of Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, Delhi, Savitribai Phule Chair of Indira Gandhi National Open University and Institute of Asian Studies, Copenhagen. To celebrate life of this organic intellectual in Gramscian sense, we have a panel members who were her co-travelers in various stages of Gail's active engagement in the grassroots movements as well as in the academia. And today's discussion on remembering Gail Omvedt, first of all, I would like her life companion, Dr. Bharat Patankar. Can you share your experiences of working with Dr. Gail Omvedt for half a century as a comrade in various social movements and co-author of several documents, pamphlets, books, and translated works? And what have been her unique contribution as a social thinker, according to you? Over to Dr. Bharat Patankar.
Yes.
Sound, it is mute. Thank you for inviting me in this program. Though I am in the period of grief and sorrow, because it is on Gail's contributions, I am trying to participate in this. It would be very lengthy to talk what Vibhuti has said in that vein, because that would be, there is a bigger theme involved in what Vibhuti expected me to talk about. But I will briefly present her contributions, what I think are her contributions, because I had been less in academia and more in movement, past movement and functioning. I had been functioning as an activist. I think that the theme which you people have framed, that class, caste, gender, and land. So, first book which she wrote was PhD thesis was Cultural Revolt in Western India, Non-Brahmin Movement in Maharashtra. The first time Phule was seen as a contributor to the theory of theory which could encompass all these aspects in one perspective. Phule was generally up to that point of time was seen as a person who opened his water tank in front of his house for the untouchables. He opened a school for girls and roughly around this was the Phule's work. And up to now, popularly speaking, and general impression about his contribution is not going beyond this kind of a sector. But what Gail did was that she presented Phule's dream of coming up with alternative mode of production, alternative mode of living by abolishing the existing kind of a mode of production, existing kind of a culture, existing kind of the land relations, existing kind of the land-water relations, and a relation of humans with the nature. So because Phule talked not only about caste, class, gender in a separate way, but he brought these things, all these aspects together into a single dream. of abolishing all these exploitations and having a different relation with the nature, which would be the humane relation, which would can be called as that we and nature. That was not the perspective of Pule, but it was that we are part of the nature. We are also a nature. So this was brought forward by Gail, and that is why Pule's the perspective of looking towards Pule. For example, I will give just one sample of that, one example of that. That Pule says in his whip cord of the farmers that government should, irrigation department should bring out one outlet of the pipe in the farm of the every farmer, which could give a water which is sufficient for the nature of that land, the area of that land, and nature of the crop, not more than that and not less than that. So actually, this is the basics of the modern way of looking towards land water relationship. And even now, irrigation department has not able to come to this kind of a scientific way of relation with land and water and equitable water distribution to all people. So in this way, if you go ahead and even about Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, it was that Dalit, he was related mainly to the liberation of Dalits, mainly to the abolition of the exploitation of Dalits. Gail brought forward that it is not so. In Mahar Satyagraha, she brought forward that it was not, Babasaheb said that it was not touching the water only, but it was more than that. It is a struggle for democracy. It is struggling for social democracy. And so the very different perspective of looking towards Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. And basically she concentrated on his viewpoint towards Buddhism and his viewpoint towards the abolition of caste mode of production, exploitation, caste, abolition of caste, exploitation, that annihilation of caste. At the same time, when she wrote about Buddha, she looked towards Buddha as bringing about change in a system of relations in those days. For example, abolition of the Dasa Pratha, abolition of the chattel, it was not a chattel slavery, but it was a land-related different kind of a slavery in India. So, which was called as a Dasa Shudras. Those people were called as Dasa Shudras. So, it was not only a philosophy of going towards kind of a from sorrow to the sabba dukkha to sabba mangala, but it was also for achieving that, Buddha also intervened in the concrete situation of the human relations that she brought forward more and more in that book. But her height of the whole thing, I think she said she had a perspective that this is not going to happen only with the help of the movement to change the mode of production, movement to change the relations of production, movement to bring about a new kind of a relations of production and mode of production. But it requires certain kind of ideology, certain kind of a different new culture. And this kind of a perspective, if it is not there, then dream cannot be a complete dream of liberation. So she brought that in more percentage. She brought forward that in a Seeking Begumpura. So Seeking Begumpura is not a scientific treaty. It is not a theoretical kind of writing, but it is a dream of a certain kind of a city where nobody is a slave, nobody is a master, nobody is restricted from going anywhere, everybody is equal, and there are no taxes, no restrictions, etc., etc. And she also looked towards in seeking Vengampura along with Ravidas or Raidas. Also took same Tukuma is also dealt with by Gail. So he comes forward with the human relations with nature. Vrukshavalli Amaso Ere, that is the one of the Marathi abhang of him. Even looking towards the, we'll smash the prison. If you look towards that, then it will be not only one aspect of the woman's liberation. Relating that to the land, caste and class. Totality of the liberation, women's liberation, would be coming only if she is liberated through all these exploitations, not one kind of exploitation, not only the exploitation at home, not only the exploitation of the workplace, but in all these aspects, she should be liberated. And that would be a struggle of women themselves. And it should be a mass struggle. It is not some project of education or project of taking some kind of a change in one pocket, but it should be a mass upsurge of women which would be bringing about this change, which is related to the totality of the change. So dream cannot be partialized. Her main thing was, so dream of the alternative society cannot be seen in a fragments or a coalition of the fragments. It should be a whole dream, a totality of the dream. And all these aspects should be part of that, not the summation of that. So in that sense, I would say that is the real contribution of Gail to the questions which we have taken. Otherwise, I would say that from, for example, the way we have put forward these questions, she would have said, if she was there alive, that you should add a water to it, land dash water, class, caste, gender. So, because water is a condition of production for production of the crops in the land. Without that, there cannot be a reliable agriculture. There cannot be a productive, reliable agriculture. And then she relates with the equitable water distribution. People who don't own land, they also should get water for agriculture. That kind of a concept only could be coming with the question of land only if we relate water with land and not separately propose land as a central point, only land as a central point of the change change of the relations of production. So I think I will stop here and
to know that how did you find her as an activist or a person who combined theory with praxis, just as response over last 5 days.
A person coming from a country where all of us know that what kind of country she was coming from. But she traveled through mud in a pouring rains. We have, along with me, in Adivasi areas, and she didn't care for getting drenched with the pouring of the rain and going through the mud path. She never cared for getting sunburn while going in a very hot sun and going for toilet in the open as other women in the villages go, because there was no alternative, and she never complained about it. She was very happy with the situation, in the sense that yet this situation has to be changed. So what is shift, in a way, what is the real activism? What is the taste for the activist who is bound with the people and who doesn't care for our one's own old habits? That was shown in practice by Gail. So in the drought-prone areas, she never cared for the whole clothes getting drenched with the dust. And in a rainy, high rainfall area, she never cared for the rain and the mud. So that was her nature. Not only that, her one friend was Tarabai. And she was not her acquaintance, but she was a friend. And she was a sweeper. I have come across Tarabai walking with Gail, going towards some house in Pune to the friends. In the morning, early morning, many times Tarabai used to meet Gail or us on the footpaths while she was actually sweeping, doing her work. But Tarabai was not, I never saw her, Tarabai saying that, "Oh, Gail, madam," etc. But she was very, she used to come and embrace her. And there was no hierarchy at all. So many women like this were there. Even Thagibai in Chada and etc. She was real activist, and she never imposed herself. She never said that I have written so many books anywhere. I not heard that. And she never said that you put me on the dais and from there I will speak. Many times she was not on the dais at all. So, but she worked as an activist. So, an activist. So that all in short, that would be the experience. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
One thing more I will say that which is not a good, our generation had that, you can say a drawback, or it was positive thing. I'm not able to decide even now that our daughter, when she was a baby, there was a Samta March after Marathwada killings, name changing of the university to the Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Marathwada University. And she was 8 months old. She was on the back of my mother and her and some activists, turn by turn. And they were walking for almost 120 kilometers from the extreme one end of the Dhule district to Dhule. And she fell ill. She had very worst kind of a diarrhea and dehydration. Even in those kind of situations, she never went away from there. And she started crying only when we reached Dhule, when they reached Dhule and program was over. And then she came out with all the emotions. But that didn't come in between herself and the participation in that. So actually, this is not exactly, it is not very easy to decide whether it was our nature. Everybody of us was like that in those days. Maybe there is.
Gail was the first to even acknowledge our Padyatra 48 villages during Namantar riots. And the findings were challenged by so many progressive people about Dalit women being mass rape. And Gail said, no, she corroborated. And even in the public meeting, she endorsed the findings of our report. No? Yeah, Bharat. Thank you. Thank you, Bharat. We are so touched by that you could speak today with us. No? Yeah. So now I come to Professor Manisha Desai, who comes from Gail's country originally. But so you have been engaged with transnational feminism. And how do you analyze Gail's contribution from the prism of global feminist solidarity? what has been the global impact of voluminous intellectual contribution of Dr. Gail Omvedt, because Bharat told us a lot about the local struggles. So can we move to global perspective that Gail evolved?
First of all, I want to extend my condolences to Bharat, to Prachi, who was there briefly. I don't know if she's still there or not. And of course, to the large family that Gail leaves behind, family of comrades in struggle, who, you know, are all across not just India, but in other parts of the world. So my deepest condolences to everybody. I also want to thank you, Vibhuti, and people at IMPRI for inviting me to provide my thoughts on Gail's contribution. I first encountered Gail, not personally, but through her work, We Will Smash This Prison, the book that Bharat has already referenced and you and Mahima all referenced. And at that time I was a graduate student and my dissertation work was on the women's movement in Western India, particularly in Maharashtra and Gujarat. Reading that book was so inspiring because Gail had, and you see that in all her work, the ability to have complex theoretical ideas written very accessibly, but always in the context of rich empirical and substantive work, but also with that commitment to social justice and to change. And so it was really for a graduate student, not only inspiring, but I have to say a little bit intimidating, thinking, oh my gosh, what am I going to add to the scholarship? You know, Gail has already done and said whatever there is to say. But I first met her then in the course of my doctoral dissertation, when I interviewed her and both Indutai and Kasigao, and she and Bharat and Prachi, all of them, welcomed me, you know, during that time and afterwards. And since then, over the years, we've met in lots of gatherings, both academic and activist, and she's always remained a generous interlocutor for my own work, but also for the work that we are all committed to, namely a better world for everyone. So since you asked me to talk about, you know, her contributions in a global perspective, I'm going to talk about two things, because her work, as we all know, is wide-ranging and so prolific that it would be, you know, hard to do justice to that. So I want to focus on two things where I see that she's really made a terrific influence and actually shaped the entire field in two particular ways globally. One is I want to talk about her influence on transnational feminism, the academic discourse of transnational feminism. And then I want to talk about her influence actually on what I call subaltern feminisms, which is mass women's movements all around the world. So those are the two things I'm going to focus on specifically. Now, transnational women's movements, as most of us know, have a long history of over a century, you know, right from the middle of the 19th century to today. But transnational feminism as an academic discourse really originates in the US Academy, particularly to deal with some of its own internal debates around women's studies, but also in response to the decade-long UN Women's Conference and the kind of mobilizations all around the world that were happening. And what's interesting is that even though transnational feminism as an academic discourse originates in the US, almost all of the scholars who have written primarily about it are of Indian origin. And that would include Chandra Mohanty, Inderpal Grewal, myself, Richa Nagar, Leela Fernandez, and Vrishali Patil, to name just a few of them. And all of us were very much influenced by the work of Gail, Maria Mies, and in what we brought to transnational feminism, I think were two very important things. One was that just as Gail did for caste, to in a way kind of turn things upside down, which is to say that caste was not just, you know, a cultural category, but a material social relations of both production and consumption in which class was therefore in some ways defined by caste, not the other way around, you know. So that's how she kind of turned upside down. But that patriarchal structures were very much important to this kind of matrix, right? So in a way that kind of influenced a lot of what transnational feminism was talking about in the 1990s, which is that one has to think about both women's oppression as well as women's struggles as historically specific, materially concrete, changing realities, both during pre-colonial, colonial, and post-colonial political economies, right? And so I think that was kind of one of the most important ways in which transnational feminism defined what, you know, women's oppression and women's liberation was across the world. And this was, you have to remember, in the context of the day that in the 1970s and 1980s, what was then called global feminism or international feminism really had this very homogeneous way of thinking about women's oppression, as though women's oppression everywhere was exactly the same, that it was unchanging. But particularly women from what today we call the global north, or what then was called the first world, essentially saw themselves as kind of autonomous agents with, you know, freedom in a kind of liberal political economy, versus women from the global south, or, you know, at the time third world, were seen primarily as victims of oppression of tradition that was unchanging. So in that context, then, for transnational feminism to rearticulate, drawing upon Gail's work, of the importance of seeing women's oppression through the lens of caste and class and land, right? In addition to seeing it concretely as changing historically and dynamically, I think was very important. And I think today it is even more important, because right now among the debates in feminisms almost all over are the debates of decolonizing feminism. And when scholars are talking about decolonizing feminism, the focus is on the rupture with colonialism, as though before colonialism, you know, there weren't unequal relationships around gender, caste, or class. And so I think Gail's work in that sense, way back in the 70s and 80s when she was writing, actually already prefigures today what we, you know, use as a buzzword, namely intersectional feminism, or the intersection of class, caste, and gender. So in that sense, Gail was already prefiguring intersectionality. But moreover, I think importantly, it's important to remember, given her historical context, that she was also in some ways echoing the work of actually African-American and Black feminists in the 19th century, like Sojourner Truth, who were also talking about the material specificity of race in the context of the US, and class, and women's oppression of enslaved men and women. So in that sense, kind of going back, you know, to the 19th century US struggles and coming forward, you know, to the 20th century, Gail was already talking about the matrix of domination, you know, that were historically concrete and specific, but that actually had a material and concrete and dynamic relationship. That was very important, that these were not static relationships. And as they changed, we needed to actually change our analysis, but most importantly, not just our analysis, but the way in which we organize and mobilize. And that's kind of where I'm going to go to next, is her influence really on what I call subaltern feminisms. And by subaltern feminisms, I really mean mass movements of women, particularly rural women, but also urban poor women, not just in the global South, because that's something we're familiar with, but also in the global North. Because right now, if you look at the kind of, so in the US in particular, right now we have feminism for the 99%, which is talking really about Black and brown poor women who are mostly in the service sector, particularly in healthcare. As we know, with COVID, they've borne the majority of the brunt in terms of not just work and labor, but also layoffs and unemployment. So kind of the resurgence of feminism for 99%, or the International Women's Strike, or if you think about Via Campesina, which started in Brazil, but is now global, or if you think about the World March of Women, all of these are women's movements of subaltern women around the world, but that are specifically influenced, I think, in three ways by Gail's work. One is the issue of land, right? The issue of land, access to land, is really crucial, particularly for most of the rural movements that I talked about in the Americas, for indigenous feminists in particular, both in North and South America, as well as in Africa. The access to land and the way in which that access to land can enable them to essentially deal with issues of material deprivation, of issues of political power, as well as social power in their communities. So that's kind of one way in which today's subaltern feminists kind of, you know, draw upon Gail's work and focus on land. And as Bharat rightly said, land and the water connected to it. And the second way is really talking about ecological issues. And one of the things I remember very clearly, because when I interviewed Gail, you know, in the late 80s and around 87, 89, there was also the movement to build the local dam in around in Maharashtra. And what she emphasized very much was that when we are thinking about ecological issues, we needed to rely on local understandings of relationship to land, water, and nature. And there, women's knowledge and women's traditions were really important to draw upon. And you see that now happening in all of these subaltern feminist movements, kind of going back to women's knowledge, women's ecological knowledge, whether we think about, you know, the ways in which, for example, in Bolivia, you know, if you think about giving rights to Pachamama, that is giving rights to Mother Earth. In New Zealand, the Maoris have given rights to the rivers. So all of those in some ways kind of draw upon Gail's work about ecology and local knowledge and drawing upon those kind of local traditions. And finally, I think it would be remiss to not remember that one of the things that I think Gail does so brilliantly, not just for caste and class in India, but I think from which we can, you know, learn for particularly almost everywhere, is that she really talked about the fact that even rural poor women are not a homogeneous group, that they're internally differentiated. So her work, for example, on paritaktas and the women who were deserted, women who didn't have land, I think all of that already in some ways gestures that we need to be paying attention, even when we're looking at subaltern women, among the internal differences within them. And so that we do not organize around false binaries, right, of poor women versus rural women, poor women versus agricultural laborers versus non-landed peasant and cultivating women. And I think that was really very important. And I think this is something that we're all struggling with, because on one hand, if you don't have these binaries, it makes it that much harder to organize. How do you then organize if you're not talking about identities, which is very often what happens when we talk about issues related to caste, class, or gender? Rather than identities, if you're talking about social relations of production, consumption, then organizing becomes that much harder. But nonetheless, that's the kind of organizing we need to do if you're going to, you know, talk about social revolution. And in that sense, I think Gail, one could say, is truly a Marxist, that like Marx, she understood that theorizing was not just to understand the world, but it was really to change it, right? And for her then, you know, that kind of change was very important. And so to build that kind of, you know, cross different location coalitions is really very important. And I think that's something that Gail has also contributed in terms of how we need to think beyond binaries to the internally dynamic and differentiated, even rural women, was very important to her. And while it's difficult, I think she also gave us some directions in where we might want to look to bring together this kind of differentiated class, caste group of rural and urban women. And I think Bharat already alluded to that, and that was in Seeking Begumpura, because I think there she draws upon the utopic vision of a lot of subaltern, a lot of the bhakti, you know, saints that she draws upon in that book were really subaltern people who actually talked about the ways in which you could still, as a subaltern person, include those who had actually continued to oppress them if you had a different social imaginary, a different utopia of a different kind of society. So I think Gail kind of, even as she showed us the ways in which things were complicated and difficult and not so binary, also provided in directions to look for in terms of how we can still build these kind of cross class, caste, and gender collaborations, because the change we need really has to be holistic, and it cannot be divided, as Bharat said, in kinds of identities, that it has to be a holistic vision. And I think that kind of vision is something that we need even more today than we've ever needed, not just because of COVID and climate change, but also because both of them demonstrate how COVID and climate change does not have the same impact for everyone. The inequalities, the social inequalities, get reproduced even in these large scale global contexts. And so I think as we go forward, we really can draw upon the various insights Gail had in terms of both transnational feminism, but also subaltern feminism, to kind of really think about how we organize, how we theorize, and what are the directions in which, you know, we need to look, as she demonstrated, you know, from saints and scholars and poets to essentially reframing, her reframing of Phule, for example, as, you know, social activist has influenced me in my work now of talking about Savitri Bai Phule as a social theorist, not just a social reformer or an activist. And so I think she's given all of us lots of different directions of ways of rethinking, retheorizing, so that we can work towards this kind of Begumpura, but it is a society where there is justice for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Manisha Desai, for encapsulating vast body of work of Gail, and that to both her theorization, your actual experience with her, and your interconnections of political economy and the question of identity, and also the material reality relations of productions, right from local to global level, you have portrayed in such a succinct and very lucid erudite style. Now, I would like to ask Dr. Surinder Jodhka about the 1 minute. Okay, yeah. My question to Dr. Surinder Jodhka is, what has been the path-breaking contribution of Gail Omvedt with regards to caste and agrarian questions, which Dr. Bharat Patankar also mentioned, but you can go into your sociological analysis, and how was her relationship with profession of sociology in India and her significant contributions for the growth of sociology as an academic discipline? Over to Dr. Professor Surinder Jodhka.
Thank you very much for organizing this, and thank you very much for inviting me, asking me to be part of this. I truly feel honored to be here, and it's really something that really gives me a lot of satisfaction that I'm also participating in this meeting. Let me begin by saying that we must convey our condolences to Bharat and her daughter. But honestly, if I see around me over the last 1 week, ever since she died, I think she died on 25th, from 26th onwards, what I'm seeing is that Gail has actually come alive. Almost everyone is talking about Gail in India. You pick up any newspaper, any website, I read at least 2 to 3 pieces written on Gail every day. I have not seen anyone who has been celebrated so much after their death. Initially, I thought maybe, you know, day one, there would be one thing in Indian Express, maybe in Hindu, and 1 or 2 things over here and there, and maybe the kind of, you know, odd websites will have some pieces. But no, it's like mainstream media. Everywhere, Gail has come alive. And I think I'm using the word alive and underlining it, and why I'm using that, I'll come to it. I want to also speak about Gail as a sociologist. There are questions that I've been struggling with, and I think Gail did not even have to struggle with, because she was not located in the profession of sociology. I think Indian sociology, even though I think sociology is a little more critical, but all social sciences at some level are still continuing to work within the larger framework of Orientalism and what Bernard Cohn describes as colonial forms of knowledge. Most of the categories of mainstream social sciences are not only Western categories, but they're also categories which Western scholars used for India. And in this process, they also at some level produce a particular kind of way of talking about India, the way, you know, my earlier speaker has been talking about, you know, you need to talk about transnational feminism, because those questions are assumed to be, you know, understood in a particular manner. So I think why does that happen? You know, even despite Gail, despite Ambedkar, despite many critiques of Orientalism, from the 19th century onwards, it has in some sense entrenched sociology. And that's a very, very important point if we have to talk about Gail meaningfully. It has entrenched because I think Orientalism became a kind of part of the nationalist imagination of India. And through nationalism and through nationalist writings, I obviously don't include people like Ambedkar in it. Ambedkar never wanted to be called a nationalist, and nationalists also did not see him as a nationalist, but I'm talking about other mainstream nationalists at some level very actively worked with Orientalist categories, and whether it is village or agriculture or caste particularly, they all continue to work with the Hindu idea of India, Hindu idea of caste, and Hindu notion of Varna hierarchy, and that as if was actual history of India, actual past of history, actual past. So that at some level has come to be a common sense of India. And Gail writes it in her book on caste, that how almost everyone continues to believe in those ideas. And that is something which she kind of confronted all her life. And I think she was very aware of this. How did Gail escape from this? And I think this is very important. I'm saying this because I'll come to the other point at the end, that Gail is very, very important for us. And we need to learn from Gail. How did she escape from this? Obviously, she herself came from a very specific context. She was not just an American. She was not just a white woman. She was not just a Westerner. She also was a kind of activist in the 70s. We already had in American sociology a different tradition with people like C. Wright Mills, who were talking about critical imaginations and stuff like that. And obviously the anti-Vietnam war movement, and Gail in some sense very kind of, you know, I remember we worked together very briefly, and in that kind of association at Surat, in one of the evenings, she sang that song, which was, you know, little boxes, and it is, and that was in 1990. She still remembered that. So I think that context, her youth was with her all her life. And she had learned those, some of those ideas picked up from there, which in some sense came into her personality in the way she looked at things, that the world needs to be changed, as has been earlier also underlined by many people. So unlike everyone else, you know, the lots of people who the word subaltern was used earlier, but social anthropology particularly did not really have the problem of being only elitist. You know, people like M.N. Srinivas did talk about that we need to do field view of caste, field view of village, because the book view was very Brahminical. But what do? They go with functionalism and look at the social structure of village and then see how Jajmani system is in some sense producing an integrated community, even though hierarchical, but there is harmony, there are harmonic system, and there is no conflict in caste. And then they again, at some level, work with the idea of Varna. Gail, without really making any noise about it, starts talking about caste by looking at modern history. She goes and studies Fule, and she makes this point, and that point I think needs to be reiterated all the time. And Bharat also kind of underlined that point, that even today Fule is seen as a reformer. Even sometime Ambedkar is described as a social reformer. These were not social reformers. They were revolutionaries. That was a cultural revolt. And this is something that Gail kept repeating all her life. And I'm happy that Bharat also underlined that point. And I think that is very, very important. I think that's what shaped her methodology. That shaped her methodology because she did not look at caste as a consensual system. She did not look at caste through the Brahminical writings, which in some sense become resource for talking about caste globally. People like, you know, Louis Dumont, even though they are working in 60s, but they still go and see that there is something called structure of caste. And this structure of caste can be unearthed as an ideal type, and then you can study. They were not talking about structure of caste. They were talking about, as Gail would very rightly say, how Brahminical system of thinking about India ought to be used to study everyone in India, even a kind of lowest untouchable, in a sense, worries about his future life, and that future life is attained only through Brahman and next Janma. And this is kind of, you know, myth that was created, and this myth suited the nationalists. This myth continues to suit most of the mainstream sociology today. And that's why I'm talking about that we need to kind of not forget these things. So I think that was also perhaps the reason that Gail came to be accepted after she turned 60 or 70, perhaps, by section of the mainstream sociology, because by that time, sociology itself had become very diverse. But if you go back to 90s, when I entered the discipline as a young faculty member, up to, I mean, or when I was a student in late 80s or 80s, Gail was already very extensively published. And some of her writings were very kind of, you know, in some sense, you could not ignore them, but they were not celebrated writings. You know, she was not in that sense seen as a sociologist who is giving contribution, who is making contribution. Her works were not discussed in seminars. And I think that's something which we must recognize, that there is something called establishment sociology, which has its own history, which has its own kind of, you know, ideological mooring at some level, but it also kind of reproduces the popular orientalist, nationalist common sense, which at some level then constructs an idea of India, which is very Hindu. And within that, there's a particular view of caste hierarchy that Gail is actually right from the beginning, very actively trying to contest. And I think this whole idea about intersectionality, again, this is something which is really beautiful in Gail. She does not use these words, right? And mm-hmm. She does not really have any problem when she's talking about caste through the perspective of class, when she's talking about class through the perspective of caste, water, gender, come in very easily. And that's because she's not reading, or she's not worried about referring to French philosophers or the stalwart of emerging culture studies in US, and she's not seeking recognition there. She's very happy publishing her pieces in EPW. Not that she did not publish in other journals. She did publish in quote-unquote refereed journals. She published books from, you know, top publishers, and her material was used everywhere. But she did not seek those kinds of, you know, Google Scholar recognitions. And I think that is what enabled her to kind of speak what she saw. And that is the biggest challenge for social sciences in India. We don't speak what we see. We speak what we think will be heard and appreciated. And I think that's how we kind of get trapped in a particular narrative, which is, again, in some sense, reproducing domination. I'll try to kind of wind up in next 2-3 minutes. My final point is that we should not see Gail as an end product. Gail has written very extensively, and I think Gail explored many different things. And this is the point that I was trying to make, that over the last 1 week, Gail has come alive. And I think there's a large number of people who at some level recognize her contribution, and that itself tells us about her contribution. In some sense, the point that was being made, that society has already changed. So there's a large number of scholars who are coming from so-called margins, and they have acquired their own confidence, and they speak their own voice. And I think this voice needs to be spoken more confidently, the way Gail spoke, you know, without really worrying about citations, and without, not that we should not be professionally rigorous, as Bharat was saying, that she was all the time walking and talking and meeting people, and then realizing that, you know, over the kind of her career, in between, she began to talk about Shetkari Sagatna and land in a very particular manner. But then she kind of came back to caste. She came back to Dalit question. She came back to Ambedkar. And this was not something which was a planned career. This was something which was happening in some sense very easily for her, because she was located in the field. She was tied to people. She was trying to kind of connect with and trying to learn from there. And then she saw that, you know, Ambedkar is a point that brings people together. Phule is a point that gives you a larger, at some level, vision and Bahujan category. So we are not really, in that sense, minority. And these become very critical political points as well. And conceptually, I think there's a lot of scope for developing these. That's why I'm saying that she is a very, very fertile material on which I think our generation and next generation of scholars need to work. And I think we need to spend a lot of time on Gail's writing, like we have the classical writings. Gail is not really, in that sense, just a scholar. She's something else. She's something much more than that. Even when she's writing just small para, chapters sometimes are 5 pages long, 7 pages long, but there is so much in it. And why is it that, you know, Begumpura comes at the end? This is very, very critical. I think that's something that the unity of, you know, what one should say, science and normatives. You know, we can't escape from, we do, all of us, if we come to social sciences, we do have politics, but that doesn't mean that we won't have objectivity. We should have honesty, we should have objectivity, but at the same time, if it is not feeding into building a new society which is based on love, which is based on affection, why does she pick up Begumpura or Guru Ravidas for conveying this utopia? So other people will struggle, you know, Eurocentrism, Western, and this. There are these concepts available. Now the Begumpura is significant, not because it is, you know, Raidas is a Dalit himself, but he's also talking about a city, right? The whole world, including all our sociologists, say that India lives in its villages. And Ravidas is writing in 15th century, and he's talking about a city without sorrow. So Begumpura is not a village. Begumpura has its own anonymity. Begumpura is an urban life. Begumpura is, in that sense, you know, very modern, if you want to use that word. And I think that's where we need to, at some level, need to recognize that this is our responsibility to use Gail. Gail is a resource for us on which we need to, at some level, build a scholarship, a new sociology of India, and also, as has been, you know, the way you have organized it, perhaps also a new feminism of India, new culture studies of India. And for her, materiality is very, very significant. How you cannot talk about caste, Bharat was talking about, you cannot talk about ideology, but you also cannot talk about materiality. How can you think about caste as Hindu mind and land as separately? So these are things which have to be seen as they are, rather than, you know, trying to fit them into some categories which were popular in kind of, you know, 1960s in France or, you know, 1990s in US, and then kind of, you know, try to say that we are the most fashionable and latest scholarship. And I think Gail gives us that source through which we can talk about grounds as they are confidently, but also recognizing the politics of their structuring and the politics of their representation simultaneously. I think I've taken 10 minutes, I'll stop here. Yeah. Thank you very much again. And I really feel honored to be part of this group.
Thank you, Professor Surinder Jodhka, for such an important ending with that to build a new society, you also need new scholarship. And I think society based on mutual respect and religious harmony and the dream and the utopia of the old saint poets and also the feminist utopia. I think that Gail brought together. To continue this discourse, I would like to ask Professor Arvinder Ansari that how do you see Gail Omvedt's contribution towards secular humanism and also liberation theology from a gender lens?
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Vibhuti. And I would really like to thank this platform giving me chance to pay my homage to Dr. Gail Omvedt. She has written so much, and I feel that a legendary like her has, as Professor Jodhka pointed out, has come alive, you know, in these few days. We have seen the kind of writings, right from land, class, gender to secularism. There are so much of things, and one is really, one doesn't know how to, you know, kind of put it together. And Gail, as has been talked by my earlier predecessor speakers, they have talked about Gail's humanism, which was very much rooted into the philosophy of a very different kind of relationship with the divine, the spiritual. And that we see, you know, is reflected in many of her works. So, you know, as we all know that liberation theology talks about, it has its roots in Christian theology, which basically talks about a preferential option for the poor, where, you know, the subaltern perspective is very important, and where these voices of subalterns are talking about non-Brahmic perspective. Now, this whole understanding of liberation theology also is, makes me to, you know, without discussing fully, it is not possible to talk about the understanding of the philosophy which, Gail had shared. Fully talked about a public religion of truth. And this is the religion of truth, which was based on broad humanistic monotheism, stressing the equality of each and every woman and man. That is very important, and that's very central to the relationships, the whole critique of Brahminical caste, which talked about Hinduism, which was based on Varnashram Dharma, and how it kind of exploited the subalterns is very important aspect, and how, you know, by evoking the voices from the subalterns, Gail had talked about this utopia, where she talks about this, that how, in fact, taking cue from Thomas More's work, the best statement of Commonwealth and the New Island of Utopia, where he emphasizes humanism, which had promised a more balanced modernity, one uniting reason with emotion, universalism with the concern for particular and diversities. It is very important that how, you know, the diversities have to be preserved and cherished. So this, this utopia, which Gail talks about in Seeking Begumpura in context of, ecatasy is also very important, where she talks about a city which is without sorrow, and taking from Ravi Das, where it says that it's a city which is casteless, classless society, a modern society, one without mention of temples and urban society, as you know, and one could move freely into it. So the whole idea was a society which is free of any kind of limitations, checks, which definitely emerged from the experience, the ground experience, which has influenced Gail's work when she was doing her empirical work, and especially from the Phule's philosophy, where he had, you know, he talked about Balipuram, where he said that the, and somehow, somewhere Gail was also, you know, had mentioned that the voices which come from Dalits, the voices which come from subalterns are very important voices to kind of create a world which is more secular, where you can, you know, you can interact, you can form relations. And somewhere, you know, Gail is also questioning, she had the guts to question that when we talk about shining India, is it a shining India when we have so many riots happening, we have so many polarization happenings, the identity debates becoming very sharp. So, you know, how can we claim that we are, you know, we are a shining India? That is what she questions, that are we shining India? So, you know, and the guts to question is something, to critically engage with the reality is very important. And through, you know, her seminal work, you know, Seeking Begumpura, because I take as a very important, you know, work in terms of what she gives a hope, and she gives hope in form of reason and ecstasy. And she says that, you know, this ecstasy gives hope, and it gives hopes to the subalterns that there will be a better world. And, you know, what has happened is that this indifference which has seeped into our lives these days, when we look at the heightened communalism, we have extended beyond communalism, you know, the kind of programs she's talked about, Gujarat riots, and where the agency of women as perpetrators has also been used, but women's agency as peace is also very important. And so she's talking about Sri Shakti, which is entrenched, which is embedded in bhakti and virangana. She's talking about that kind of Sri Shakti, which is very important and significant to bring peace in the society. So, you know, when she's talking about reason and ecstasy, she says that they are utopias, not simple fantasies, because they have foothold in reality and yet contradict the uglier aspects of reality. You know, this ray of hope which Gail provides through her writings, which gives a lot of confidence. You know, what happens when you feel that, okay, and when she becomes the voice of voiceless, the ability to talk about Ramiza B, talking about the naked realities, talking about the brutalities, the exploitation of women, not only in the public domain, also talking about the site of violence in the family. And very wonderfully, you know, in fact, both Ambedkar and Phule have said that the primary site of violence is family. And unless and until we address the relationship between men and women, we cannot address the violence, exploitation, and marginalization of communities and societies where women are marginalized. So, you know, this is and this is not only in the form of ideology. It is talking, Gail also talks about experiences. And when we look at the liberation theology, which also talks about marginals and poor and giving hope them. And why theology is very important? Because theology is very important because it is touching the code of humanism. And somewhere Gail is also hinting that, you know, there has to be a dialogue between with the divine. And we see, you know, whether it is Islamic feminism or it is Dalit feminism or it is Black feminism, they are getting strength from this discourse which is there, that there is struggle, but there is the scope that they can change this world. So, you know, these ecstasies, the utopias, which not only provide hope and even ecstasy to the masses, that, you know, that we have to struggle, is something very important. And the picture which you
have, Arvinda, participants are saying, increase the volume of your audio.
Okay.
Okay.
is it okay now?
Yeah, now it's fine. Now it's
okay.
Fine.
Okay, okay. So, you know, I was coming to the picture which you had posted on the Facebook where Gail is taking minutes. That talks about her, you know, dedication. And, you know, this had an impact when I was just reminded of NTCA protest at Shinebagh, where I saw girls very, you know, getting their motivation from Gail and that participation of bringing the change, the agency. So Gail very well knew and was aware about the agency of women, and she's talked about the agency of women. And she was also aware of the limitation which is there. She also talked about the limitation. Very interestingly, she talks about that, you know, especially Dalit women and women from, you know, OBCs who become part of the resistance movement, they are very active. Because why are women very active? Why women are there, and why, you know, they are outspoken, they have a militant voices. When I say militant voices, you know, they are very simple, and you know, they are not very diplomatic. They are not very, you know, kind of shrewd. There is no duality. In fact, she's talking about that simplicity where they become the voice, and they become the harbingers of change. But what happens is very important, the cost they have to pay. She was very much aware about the limitations of women, the femininity, the relationship. She says that she has seen very, you know, in her many writings she's mentioning, and especially her small booklet on women and violence, where she's talking about witch hunting, where she's talking about dowry deaths, rapes, female feticide. There she is also touching this discourse that how this divide in communalism has also impacted women's movement. It has also impacted women's movement. And after Shabano, we see that there has been this polarization, or you know, there has been the rift in mainstream women's movement. The case of Imrana, Guria, all these cases throw immense light that, you know, how religion, how the hegemony in religion controls the mobility of the women. And this is what she was trying to address, that how can we, you know, kind of address this? And that is a very important question. And, you know, what Vibhuti was saying, that why, you know, secularism is more dear and more close to women is also in context of that women as mothers. And women, and my own researches I've seen in conflict area, that peace is very important. The harmony, when I talk about the harmony, the tolerance, because that is very important. You know, when I was doing my fieldwork with the half widows in Surinder, I saw that, you know, these half widows who are living the life of liminality, you know, their mobility was controlled by the religious discourses, because the scriptures, they did not allow them to get remarried. They were very young half widows who their husbands had gone missing. There was no clue whether they are dead or alive. The waiting period was 99 years. So, you know, the way, and after, so it was after so much of intervention from some women some NGOs and civil society organizations, yes, working there, that there was some amendment made. But this amendment came in 2014. This amendment came in 2014, and we see from 1989 to 2014, it was almost a lot of time which, you know, these women had lived the life of liminality. And when this amendment came, the period from 99 years was reduced to 4 years. So, you know, if, you know, I am trying to look at this in context, what Gail has talked about, the subjugation of women in religion, in scriptures, and the need to address it is very important. And it is the voices of subaltern women which are very important, which can change this discourse. In fact, Foule also talks about women's liberation, and he says that inequality in the family leads to the suppression of women and suppression of other marginalized sections of the society. And the ethnicity the identity, what we see, what we have seen, that what is happening to women, and especially in present discourse of communalism, we see how women of minority communities have been victims of triple marginalization, I would say. Say, you know, what happened to women in Gujarat is now a story which is forgotten, what we see in Muzaffarpur, or what happened in Northeast riots in Delhi. So, you know, so this whole, this pain, this trauma, this suffering of women is very central. And the only hope we have in the utopia, what Gail has provided us, that we, the voices of resistance, which are very important, we need to speak. We need to speak, and we need to speak unitedly. What Professor Manisha Desai was also talking about, global feminism. So, you know, what is the need that these issues have to be highlighted, have to be talked and to be discussed and researched? And, you know, very interestingly, very significant, what we learn from Gail's personality is also that, you know, she gave voice to the voiceless. And similarly, if we give voice to these women who are living at periphery, who are subjected to these kind of violences, would be definitely what she talked about, a Begumpura, a city free of sorrow, a city free of hierarchy, where, you know, there are no restrictions on our movements, where we can move freely, and we don't have to bother about any limitations, hierarchies, or you know, the problems which are there, which we are the co-travelers. So, you know, this is something which I really wanted to highlight in context of Gail's work, which kind of is very important. And the real enlightenment, what she says, is going to be represented in the anti-caste movements, and that will strengthen democracy, equality, and the notion of progress in our society. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Ansari. You covered such a huge canvas, right from the first protest we had when Ramiza B was gang raped and Muktadar committee was appointed, and it was a post-emergency period, and we all, whether it's Professor R. Indira, there are many friends of Gail who all of us were active. Medha Kotwali is here, Professor Ghanshyam Shah is here, and the Milind Jawan, and many social activists who fought against gender-based violence are here as participants. And I think that will also, with that, I think I would like to ask Dr. R. Idira, like Gail, she's also both a public intellectual, extremely prolific writer in Kannada and English, and also a very veteran feminist of Mysore city in Karnataka. You have been active both in women's rights movement and also women's studies movement for over 4 decades. Can you provide an overview of Gail's contribution, both as a social scientist and feminist activist, and also activist of the social movement, this action of solidarity that Gail was involved in?
Thank you, Vibhuti. Namaskar to everybody. I'm really honored to be here and given an opportunity to express my thoughts in this platform. I had the opportunity to meet Professor Gail Omvedt thrice. Once when she came to Mysore, this was, you know, early 90s, and my friend Dr. Lakshmi Narayana, who had worked with Gail, had brought her home. And the second time I met her was in 2018, when I, as president of the Indian Sociological Society, I had the honor and privilege of participating in the ceremony where the ISS conferred the Lifetime Achievement Award to Professor Omvedt. And of course, the last time I met her was in 2019 at Kolhapur. But then I, with all my colleagues here, I agree that she lives on. I have put my thoughts in writing because I don't want to overshoot my time. And I would like to speak mostly from the point of view of my experiences as a teacher of sociology and as somebody who came into the women's studies academia from the movement. So I'll hope will not take more than 10 minutes. So I would always look at Professor Gail Omvedt as a true role model, not just for sociology or gender studies theorists or practitioners, but to all those who are committed to making the academic world relevant to lived realities of the Bahujan Samaj. When I say Bahujan, I mean the diversities that characterize Indian society. Dr. Gail Omvedt lives through her works, which critically analyze the many assumed truths, and her style of writing touched so many hearts and minds. Now, Dr. Omvedt's signal contribution, one of the signal contributions to the worlds of both academics and movements, is that she symbolized the values and practices that must be inherent in the notion of academic activism. She's a social scientist who has shown us how dangerous it is to indulge in sweeping generalizations, but look at the many invisible but crucial aspects of issues such as caste, gender, labor, leadership, and social movements. Gail Omvedt is a social scientist with a difference. The benchmark that she has set is that thinking or ideology and movement must traverse together. Neither theories of caste nor gender are just a baggage of concepts or slogans, but and feminism is not, for example, just a theory but a way of life. Also, feminism is not just a one-track thought as propounded by one individual or one school of thought. So questions of gender-induced inequalities, this is something which I'm sure not just me, but many of us have learned from Gail Omvedt, that gender-induced inequalities have to be addressed in the context of other forms of inequality as created by caste, class, land ownership, or access to or denial of access to society's resources. Now, Dr. Gail Omvedt is a public intellectual whose writings, interactions, and networks, they went beyond classrooms and seminar halls into the world outside. She showed us how it is important for a concerned teacher of sociology or gender studies, or for that matter, any social science, to be at ease both in the academic zones and public debates and activist platforms. As a social scientist, Dr. Omvedt stands as an example of how, either as an academic or as an activist, one should never be carried away by hierarchies. And my friends here have already referred to that. I have been listening to programs where our colleagues are telling us how she did not have any ghostwriters, she had no drafts, and she would sit and write herself, had absolutely no complexes. Her life is a testimony to the way in which a scholar of that stature can be so simple, humane, and never make anyone feel small, while at the same time steadfastly protecting the ideals she stood for. Professor Omvedt's life is an example of how social scientists, academic activists, public intellectuals can and have to integrate into their thinking, writing, and living the real life realities that characterize the situations in which many of those deprived from society's advantages live. She showed us how we have to question ourselves, revisit questions of caste, gender, and intergroup relations, by documenting the simple truths that surround the lives of those who live in society's margins. Now, among many of her outstanding contributions to social science is the way in which Dr. Omvedt achieved in her writings a balance between superior scholarship and reflection of the realities of people's lives, which she was able to acquire by participating in local cultures, as I call them. In fact, she set the trajectory for academic activists by conveying a clear message that while documenting the woes of the groups deprived of society's resources and opportunities, these writings must also lend voices to those whose struggles we claim to put before the world. Now, the lessons that one learns from Dr. Omvedt's approach to social movements is that we have to learn to ask the question, are these movements just reactive? Or are giving a voice and space to the real concerns of those whose anguish and vulnerability we are supposed to be representing? be it women's movement, farmers' protests, or ecological movements. The questions that come up in our mind when we are reading about Gail's works on this issue is, who are the leaders? Have we been able to turn this into a pro-people movement? Are these movements really echoing the voices and concerns of the Dalit, tribal, and groups that face exploitation at different levels? Another question which has always been bothering me is about those who assume leadership of movements, appropriating the movements themselves and becoming institutions and never giving up the leadership positions and involving the people for whom they are supposed to have raised questions and issues. Now, Dr. Omvedt's writings and her life itself is a reminder to those of us in movements to revisit the entire movement's discourse and ask questions to ourselves and to others. Now, there are two more points that I just would like to make before I close. The other point, which I consider is very critical in Dr. Gail Omvedt's thinking and writing, is the fact that she wrote in Marathi and her views on the spoken language. Today, we are caught in this debate here in the state of Karnataka and elsewhere also, I'm sure, where majority of our teaching, learning, and research takes place in Kannada. And then this has created a divide between those those who use English going into private institutions, private universities, and those who are using Kannada going into the state universities. Of course, the state plays the language card as a political tool, but it also favors the private sector. But Professor Omvedt's command over Marathi and her writings in both English and Marathi showed that one need not be detached from one's language of life, as I call it, if we have to attain scholarship. I wish all those who are engaged in this discourse here read Seeking Begumpura and get insights into her views on use of spoken language. And I wish and would be very happy to have her work, you know, translated into Kannada. And I'm sure and I hope that this will be done soon, because in a debate that they were having yesterday on TV, the colleagues of mine who were there were talking about it, and I surely wish. Now, I would like to just close by raising one particular point. See, the academia today, there are exceptions, of course, you know, because I have been hearing from the morning that, Dr. Omvedt never ever showcased either her scholarship or, you know, the fame that she had. But today, one publication, I'm sorry, but this is the truth. There are many with one publication, one lecture showcase themselves so much. And it is time that we learn our lessons from the life she led, the simple, humane approach, and how she never ever showcased herself. And the last thing that I want to say, because I came into women's academia from the movement, and there is the separation today that I see. In fact, in many universities, you hear the word university women versus activists. Now, I know all of us here know that the movement and the women's studies departments worked together, in fact, came into existence together, coexisted together. But today you see a great divide, and there are many who fear activism. And so we need to talk more about Dr. Gail Omvedt's contribution. We have to understand that movement and studies come together, and that there can be no women's studies, you know, departments or women's studies programs which don't involve activism. And unless we train a generation of students and, of course, faculty who are ready to go out, because I've heard so much about, you know, how she was ready to go to the field, as we call it, I don't think the situations will improve. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you so much, ma'am. We have somehow lost Vibhuti, ma'am. She will rejoin. So over to now Dr. Ajay Gudavarte, sir. Ajay, sir.
Should we wait or should I just start?
So you can start.
Okay. Yeah. So thanks, Arjun, for this wonderful opportunity to honor and celebrate Professor Omvedt's memory and work. I would focus on, as a political theorist, what I drew from Gail's work. And I think there is a lot that one might miss if one does not pause and kind of draw on how I think Gail has done few extraordinary things in her work, which are, I think, very silent and they're not explicit. That could be the way actually she wrote and kind of theorized. And as we can see, one of the uncanny things that she did is to kind of seamlessly merge Marxism with the Dalit Bahujan philosophy. That, you know, in a context, in a political context that we are, where there seems to be at loggerheads, she both extended Marxism by incorporating the Dalit Bahujan categories of caste and other categories that she drew from Ambedkar, Phule, Buddha. She reworked historical materialism. She said that historical materialism in the Indian context, where caste has to be part of the base and it cannot simply be a construct on and so forth. So she did a few very interesting things. You know, critical theorist Nancy Fraser says that socialism is cognitively compelling, but experientially removed. And Gail, I think Gail's work, as I see as a political theorist, I think fills that gap very well. I think one of the enduring projects that she really had was to make these abstract theoretical categories kind of reflect in our everyday life processes and our everyday life experiences. I think that's her seminal contribution that we'll have to pause and read, that how experiential categories are not different from theoretical categories. Often when we teach theory and philosophy, we seem to have this wedge between normative, theoretical, abstract categories and lived experiential categories. I think Gail's work is exemplary in terms of bridging these two sides of the coin. And I think through that vantage point, there are quite a few kind of points that we need to keep in mind. There are quite many, but I'll just focus on a couple of them where I think, given the current political context that we are in, that are unique to the way, one of the unique points that she, her own reading of Ambedkar, was that Ambedkar was a kind of a universal philosopher for Professor Omvedt. And she repeated it on number of occasions that he did not write only about particular castes. He drew a philosophy from a particular caste location, but he was in fact writing for all social groups. In fact, he was talking about emancipation of caste. Even caste Hindus require emancipation from caste. And I think Ambedkar's that extending Ambedkar beyond certain specificity of location, yet drawing that experiential advantage from certain specific social location, is something I think Gail kept repeating. And that comes across, that viewpoint comes across the way she interprets, the way she has connected caste, class, and gender. I think that's a very key. I don't have the time to theoretically elaborate how she does that in her work, but I think this is something in current context we need to keep in mind, that whether she spoke about Phule or Ambedkar, she spoke of them as political thinkers who were who spoke about all sections of our society. This again closely is linked to Gail's, I think, very important thing that she did in terms of social theory is that drawing on, I mean, people have referred to Begumpura and her writings on Buddha. I think there's a reason why she did that, it's not merely about utopia, but I think the point as a political theorist I draw is that there is a subtle critique of Marxism in the way she has framed, she brought forth some of these works, that it is not breaking down annihilating caste, creating rupture is one thing, but to reconstruct a society in an ontological sense, I think it's a completely different game. We often think one is connected to other in a very linear manner, that once you start deconstructing, once you start annihilating caste, it is but natural that a new society would automatically be born. I think Gail, as a very silent but a very profound political theorist, as I read her, kept emphasizing this point that reconstruction is a different project altogether. And that's where I think she was trying to build on the first principles of what would this new society look like. And that's where drawing from Ravidasa, drawing from Tukaram, drawing from Phule and Ambedkar, I think as a political theorist, she was trying to convey this. I mean, she did it in a very subtle way. I mean, that's very interesting as to why she wouldn't put her theoretical points up front. I think it was a nagging question in my mind that I thought at some point I should meet her and talk, but obviously that I missed that opportunity, though I had the opportunity to meet her when I was doing my PhD. In fact, my PhD topic that I picked up was partly drawn from the work, nature of work that Gail Omvedt did in terms of interlinkage between caste, class, and gender. And I think therefore, as I said, there was a subtle critique of Marxism that Gail was building as part of a global South project, and which have, I think, it's our responsibility of later generations to actually pick on those deep theoretical insights, which are quite locally and experientially located, to kind of reconstruct that in much universal categories. As I said, it's a nagging question as to why Gail herself did not kind of take up this project, maybe because she was too invested in movements. The paucity of time could be a number of other reasons. Those who knew her closely would perhaps be able to make a better sense. My third point would be what the tricky question that Professor Vibhuti Patel posed to me, and she was not here when I began to speak, but I think she reserved the most difficult question for me as to why.
Ma'am is here. Ma'am, would you like to repeat the questions? Ma'am, please unmute. Vibhuti, ma'am, please unmute.
Yeah. Which I had asked you basically, that how come Dalit Bahujan scholars trusted Gail and saw her as a mother figure? And what kind of intellectual legacy has Gail left for the younger generation? And how do you see the relevance of her contribution from the subaltern perspective? I think that has been taken care of by the earlier three present, Dr. Manisha, Desai, and I think Abinder also talked about it. Professor Surinder, Jodhka went in great detail. So I think if you can focus on what makes Gail so affable to the younger generation of Dalit, Bahujan, and Adivasis.
I think that you raised a very pertinent, in fact, I was planning to speak on that, and you raised that question. I think given the current context, again, this is something really profound, what Gail achieved in terms of her social location and the kind of identification that she could generate with Dalit Bahujan activists, scholars, youth. I mean, as I've seen last 1 week on social media, not merely obituaries and intellectual tributes, but the kind of emotional outpour that I could witness among Dalit Bahujans. I think after S.R. Shankaran, who I think Dalit Bahujans kind of completely owned up, I saw this is, I think, only Gail who perhaps got that kind of an honor. And I've seen a couple of recent articles by Dilip Mandal, somebody mentioned it on chat, and Professor Kancha Ilaya, I think, who bring in this very pertinent point where we need to pause and kind of reflect that as to why Gail was kind of completely identified with, owned up by Dalit Bahujans, which may not have had other scholars who are reflecting and working on Dalit Bahujan issues. Dilip Mandal in his piece refers to Arundhati Roy and Medha Patkar, did not get. I think it's something that this is a very deep question that one needs to pause and think in terms of why this would perhaps happen. As I said, S.R. Shankaran, I coming from Telangana, I'm quite familiar with these questions. S.R. Shankaran was completely owned up. Not even activists like Dr. Bal Gopal and others got that kind of a unreserved, unabated kind of acceptance and identification. Partly of many reasons, I think her own activism, where I think Gail's way of framing questions, where, as I said, that there was no separate normative critique that was independent of the questions that were emerging from the ground. I think her entire way of framing the question, as I see, there is no separate theory that stands out. I think her theoretical framework is located within the, and they emerge from her experience. Her, I think her participation in women's movement, if you read her pieces on women's movement, I think she directly drew. So a kind of a separate self was missing in Gail's scholarship, that there was nothing separate that she was trying to invoke. Obviously, she was theorizing it as an active scholar, but I think she completely adopted that local frameworks and questions that were emerging. So I think this dichotomy that often comes through in many writings in terms of a certain kind of a theoretical normative viewpoint that stands at a distance from everyday lived experience. I think Gail did a fantastic work, both as a scholar and an activist, in terms of bridging, which is not easy. You know, these things run counter, they sometimes cancel out. It's a very complex thing that happens. But I think in Gail's own writings and her reflections, I think she beautifully bridges that gap, brings a certain normative point. It's not that Gail was not critical, and she was also critical of Dalit Bahujan politics at certain points. She was critical of the women's movement when she brought in newer points of view. She was critical of Marxism. But it's also very interesting that in India, both Marxists and Dalit Bahujans claim Gail. You know, Marxists feel that she essentially began as a Marxist scholar and extended Marxism, and they do not feel that, like many others, that she ended up abandoning Marxism, that she continued to remain a Marxist till the end. But that somehow did not, does not often work for other scholars, who get tagged. I think there is some deep model in Gail's working, which I don't think we can study at a distance, as a kind of a normative theoretical question, something that one should perhaps observe in our everyday. So I think I'm looking forward to somebody writing a very detailed, close biography of Gail, who would, and I think those details, the way she worked in these movements, I think there is a future model in this. The way she could, I think that idea of the self missing in the way she framed, which makes it so easily acceptable. Apart from the fact, obviously, she had a certain kind of a locational advantage of not belonging to the kind of a fossilized Hindu caste order. And I think the sense that Gail gives is in terms of learning from this movement, rather than either merely preaching or merely theorizing it. I think a constant feeling, I think, that gets reflected in Dilip Mandal's piece, that she did not grab the mic, but she was a kind of a co-traveler who gave a serious sense to the Dalit Bahujans, that she was continuously learning from them. I think that's a very dignifying experience for any movement. So I would argue that I think what we really need, we have had reflections on our theoretical frame, but what we really need is a very close biography of Gail Omvedt in terms of her everyday working, that how did she work with these multiple organizations? How did, because she did not write on some of these controversies, which is in itself a bit strange for me, that, but she papered them over by not explicitly framing. So I think that itself was a kind of a methodology, that you don't often have to frame them in such explicit way, but you kind of take them on by and by, those issues. And the flip side of it, that we might miss some of those insights, that if you easily bracket her in either or kind of frameworks. And I would say that we need to take a step back with a certain kind of a gestation, revisit both her activism and the writings. I think I'll stop there. Thank you.
I think you are really right, because even when one disagreed, even at the time of a peak of the movement, when one disagreed, whether it was in Narmada Bachao or Shetkari Sangatna, when she said, Sharad Joshi, aage bado, hum tumhare saath hai, many of us had reservation that how can you reconcile the class interest of the agriculture laborers, marginal farmers, and the kulaks who were also supporting Dr. Sharad Joshi, or at the time of globalization when all of us were just we were condemning the kind of policies and what ground reality that was happening because of LPG, liberalization, privatization, globalization. Gail had a different stand, and she said that this globalization is going to really attack the straitjackets and the rigid structures of caste system, and we differed with her, but none of us, no, there was no accusing finger against Gail. Nobody called her that she was bought over or she was sold out to the liberal bourgeoisie or all. So I think that one, the trust, her honesty of purpose, her commitment to the working Bahujan, Dalit Bahujan, Adivasi interest, that was never questioned. And now today is our last panelist. I think, Doctor, I would like to ask you the same question in a very, more or less the same question, that why people found Gail so trustworthy, that even when they differed with her, she enjoyed tremendous affection. And she also, like Dalit, Bahujan, Adivasi scholars and activists, they found her trustworthy. And also, what way you would see the ideological contribution of Gail Omvedt has left permanent mark among the Dalit, Bahujan tribal studies as well as the activism. Dr. Umar Khan, yes.
Thank you, Professor Patel, for giving me this opportunity to speak here today. I'm perhaps the only Dalit speaker here today.
No.
Fine, that's fine. No problem. Others may have problem, but I have no problem. I tend to disagree with some of the opinions which were aired by some of the speakers that Gail has become very popular and alive in last 1 week or so. I tend to disagree. I'll explain you why. You know, when a Dalit spokesperson, a Dalit Bahujan spokesperson or Dalit leader dies, then he or she becomes popular. During their lifetime, Kansiram was not so popular, you know. When he died, he became very popular with all the progressive people saying that Kansiram was very good, but Mayawati is bad. Perhaps when Mayawati dies, then same thing could be said about her as well. But let me come to the point of discussion here. While we are paying a tribute to Gail, I also take this opportunity to pay tribute to Elena Jelliot, to Rosalind O'Hanlon, to Sarmila Rege, to Owen Martin Lynch, you know, who came to India in 1970s, went to Agra, lived with the Jatav people there in Agra, and he wrote a brilliant book called The Politics of Untouchability. I mean, we have seen several American scholars coming to India, learning the language, staying with the people. And that's how I will try to address your first question, that what made her so affectionate to the Dalit Bahujan people in this country? You know, Professor Patel, you were the first person perhaps to write a condolence note on 25th August, which was circulated through Dalit Media Watch mailing list. Therein lies the answer to your question. You know, you have mentioned very lucidly, very affectionately, that how Gail did not make any distinction for the people with whom she was working. You know, she was attending the padyatras, rallies, and how Nandurbar, visiting this place. That means she was easily accessible to each and everyone. She had no hang-up that she's an American, she has a PhD from University of California, Berkeley. I was reading today in one of the pieces that was published, I think in the Week magazine's website, I saw that, wherein the author has mentioned that in the alumni book at University of California, Berkeley, where she did her PhD, she wrote, "I have no address." You know, this is how she was connected to the people in India. And that made her affectionate. She learned the language. She could communicate with everyone. She could write, as you have also pointed out, that in whatever style she knew about Marathi language, she was writing. And she was easily accessible. See, you know, in 1992, myself, Yogendra Sikand, and RJA interviewed Elena Jelliot in one of the meetings in JNU. And we asked her a question. What is it that would make a non-Dalit acceptable in the Dalit Bahujan movement? What is it? with your experience, could you enlighten us? I mean, for a person like you, I mean, Elena Jelliot, Gail Omvedt, these were so popular among the Dalit Bahujan community in Maharashtra and even the neighboring states like Karnataka or Andhra or to several other cities in India. They were so popular. I mean, I remember she told us that, look, any non-Dalit who has to come and join the Dalit movement or the Bahujan movement should come with the idea to play the role of a facilitator, not play the role of a leader, imposing his or her own ideas and how to do things and, you know, lead the movement. No. This is how I see the role of Gail Omvedt. She was facilitating. She was facilitating a great tradition from, you know, Buddha to Phule to Ambedkar to Sauji Maharaj to everyone, to all the great saints, which she talked about in Begumpura, which I will comment later on. That is how I feel she developed that rapport with the people. And the very fact that, like, you know, she had no hang-up of any kind, that she has written more than 25 books. You know, she's a big scholar. She should stay. I mean, I came to know about Gail when I joined JNU in 91. I read Dalit Vision for the first time in 1992. Around that time only, Professor Nanduram and Professor Sukhdev Thorat, these were the only two people who could call, you know, Gail Omvedt, who could call Elena Jelliot, who could call Kancha Elaya, you know, for seminars and conferences. There were no other teachers or centers interested, perhaps, but that apart. That is how we, who had started United Dalit Student Forum in JNU, we started inviting these people, among which Gail was also there, to have a post-dinner discussions in JNU. JNU has a tradition of post-dinner discussion, which goes well into the night. And there we met and befriended Gail Omvedt, befriended Elena Jelliot, Kancha Elaya, like many, you know, from Bombay University or Pune University or Punjab University or, you know, Merit University, from all over India, people, I mean, the scholars would come debate and discuss, you know, perspective from below or Dalit Bahujan movement, what future shape it could take. I mean, these were the two prominent, Thorat and Nanduram, who would organize regularly. And whenever these people would visit JNU, UDSF, United Dalit Student Forum, would organize a public meeting with them. And that is how we developed our relationship with them. And that is how I feel we have been following her work, Gail's work. And the biggest contribution, because the second part of your question is that, what ideological contributions she made in the Dalit, Bahujan, Adivasi studies. The biggest contribution Gail Madam made was, you know, she re-evaluated the existing sociological theoretical formulations, whether it was belonging to Marxism or liberalism or whatever, from a Dalit Bahujan perspective. She gave an alternative. She made this as part of the academic discourse. She reproduced Phule, Ambedkar, and made them as part of the academic discourse. You know, even in a place like JNU, if you read today's the in print website, there is an article by Jangam Chinnaya. He teaches Carleton University in Canada. He was a JNU student. He has written that how, you know, Gail Omvedt was confined to the underground Dalit student network. She talks about United Dalit Student Forum and how we used to organize meetings, study circle meetings, you know, late night post-dinner talks and several other things. That is how the point that I'm trying to make here is that it is the credit solely goes to Gail Omvedt for reproducing, retelling this story. Otherwise, what was the need to, you know, write about understanding caste? Ambedkar, you know, wrote about caste so many years ago. Where was the need to rewrite it? the need for rewriting it was, you know, the reiteration of what Ambedkar and Phule had already written. So that, like, you know, it becomes part of the academic discourse. It becomes part of the public discourse in India. You know, one of the reasons why we started United Dalit Student Forum, or later on Bahujan Student Forum, which is now transformed into, over the years, as BAPSA, Birsa Ambedkar Phule Student Association. Why? Because we felt that even in a progressive university like JNU, Dalits and Bahujan issues were out of the public discourse. And that is why there was a need to reiterate our position that no, we are also part of the discourse. And that is where she made the biggest contribution. In the 90s, when I was still a student here, I used to regularly read Gail Omvedt's column in The Hindu, regularly. And till whatever time it came, she wrote very many good articles. And one of the articles, if I vaguely remember, in which she criticizes the social scientists in India for not being honest to study the ramifications of caste system on the Dalits and Bahujan society, you know? And several other things she wrote. You know, she was writing in EPW. She was reading, writing, publishing, you know, here, there. I mean, she was one person. I do not know how she was dividing her family responsibilities, or, you know, she had a daughter, she had a husband, she had a mother-in-law, like, you know, as you mentioned in your post on 25th, Indutai Patankar, who herself was a big women activist. How she was managing her family and then, you know, academic responsibilities. She would be a visiting professor at several Indian universities, Ambedkar chair professor at NISWAS, IGNU. She would come to JNU. I used to work with Professor Thorat at Indian Institute of Dalit Studies when we had started it. And one of the things that we, you know, that would explain you how diverse she was in her expertise. We were doing a work on social justice philanthropy in India. And at one point of time, we got stuck. So we decided that, like, you know, we would also ask somebody to help us in carrying forward that work. And the first name, believe me, the first name that came to us, to Thorat and me, that let's contact Professor Gail Omvedt. And she readily agreed. That has come out in a book form, which was edited by Gail Omvedt, Sukhdev Thorat, and others. Other people were also involved in that thing. That is what I'm trying to say, that, like, you know, she was a true follower of Gautam Buddha. Tathagata. Gautam Buddha was called Tathagata. Why? The meaning of Tathagata is there is no difference between words and deeds. Tat jod agat. No, I found Gail to be such a, you know, wide reflection of Buddhist principles in her life, daily life, you know, struggle or daily life work that she was doing. And believe me, she popularized the Navayana Buddhism. The Buddhism in India book you must read. Because that's why I'm saying, you know, why there was a need to rewrite or retell the stories. Buddha and his Dhamma was written by Ambedkar. Where was the need to write a book on, separate book on Buddhism once again? I mean, some of my friends, Silas Darokar and Bodhi and one more person, they are now coming up with a new book called Navayana Buddhism. You know, so these are the things that talked about, and she made a big contribution in seeking Begampura. You know, she demonstrated the great philosophical tradition of Dalit Bahujans. It's an amazing story that even before you start talking about the European utopianism or European renaissance, there were people in India who were building that utopian world, that worldview, who provided an alternative worldview. And that's why it's very fascinating when she writes, when Gail Omvedt writes that neither the Ram Rajya nor the golden Vedic period will do justice to the Dalit Bahujan community in this country and the Adivasi community. On economy too, I remember she provided, Gail Omvedt provided a Bahujanvadi economic model based on the Satya Sodhak philosophy of Phule. So it was amazing. I mean, she was touching upon sociology, she was touching upon political science, she was touching upon, you know, anthropology, she was touching upon social movements, women movement, several other things. And she was like, you know, a bundle of knowledge, bundle of, you know, empathy. She had, you know, extensive experience of working among the grassroots people. She was extensively traveled person. She had, like, you know, and as Suraj Yengade wrote in a piece recently after her death, she brought these issues to the global level. And that is, I think, her contribution is amazing, mind-boggling contribution. And I think I should end here because other people have also spoken about so many other things.
Dr. Umakant, yes. I could see so many parallels because our experience of Gail in the mid-70s and late 70s.
I'm also a Dalit activist, so I can feel. That she was my, you know, I don't use the word comrade. I say she was my Bhimred.
She was my Bhimred.
I'm a Dalit activist. I worked with National Campaign on Dalit Human Rights for more than 10 years. As a student also, I've been an activist. Yeah. And I do a scholarly work.
Yeah.
So that is how I could relate myself.
Yeah. We were more into street fighting and organizing, mobilizing.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah, late 70s. There are many of our fellow comrades here as participants. Dr. Medha Kutwal, I see. We all were the ones who were in the all rallies and morchas and sit-ins and in the 70s.
Yes,
and it was a very different period because the post-emergency period, 5,000 women activists were in Indian jails.
We
know what all they had to undergo. Yeah. So I think it's a very, we got very comprehensive
amazing life story Gail. Of Gail Omvedt.
Yeah, yeah. Right amazing. From the global feminism to local activism.
Yes,
there is one very important question that I see is there have been parallel discourses in the chat box, very volatile discourses are happening.
Yes.
There is a very senior political scientist who always, right from the very beginning, in her period of struggle, who always stood by her, Professor Ghanshyam Shah. I would invite him to speak about Gail if he's there. Professor Ghanshyam Shah, are you there? Can you unmute and speak? Ghanshyam Shah, she was a visiting fellow at Center for Social Studies.
You know
that was the only institution in the 70s and 80s which did work seriously on the question of Dalit Bahujan issues. And also, it was before the Dalit studies got prestige after 2007 when Professor Sukhdev Thorat became chairperson of UGC and later on in ICSSR, that there were funds and status and academic legitimacy. But even much before that, Center for Social Studies was known for providing platform to all those who saw caste and class, the interplay of caste and class and the unfolding reality and the conflicts that Indian political scenario had it and even the social conflicts. So if Dr. Ghanshyam Shah is here, can he speak? Ghanshyam? He was there, but I don't see.
Now he's not.
He's not there. Okay. Then the floor is now open. And there was one question. Now someone has deleted it. There was one question that how can we demolish class? I think that was the general sense of it. What can we do to annihilate caste? That was good. And panelists, would like to take up this issue? And others are like, their polemics are there in the chat box also. And it is mainly about the use of word subaltern, that it is an epistemological violence and we should replace subaltern with Dalit Bahujan Adivasi. So, and then I think the speakers have, I think Dr. Indira Ramarao has said that yes, she accepts that. And, but otherwise who would like to, anyone who wants to either speak or ask questions or extend the arguments posed by the panelists. The floor is open now. Now then, can I ask the panelists to sum up the issue after you saw the six presentations and also my introduction. How would you like to sum up Gail's contribution as a social scientist and as a practitioner? Can we start with Dr. Manisha Desai?
Yeah. Sure. I think one of the things that Gail did consistently and well, as I think Dr. Pant mentioned and Dr. Gunawarthy mentioned, is that she was part of the movement, that she did live and practice, that she didn't necessarily just come and use, you know, movements for her own good, but that she actually lived and was part of the struggle. And I think that's something that we can all take in terms of how do we work, you know, the ethics of our work and how those of us who work on social movements, we might participate, but, you know, is it to extract or is it to facilitate? I think is also maybe Dr. Umakant. So I think that's a lesson that is very important.
So the line between solidarity and appropriation, I think that's very, very important that we as a practitioner and social theorists should keep into consideration. What would you like to say, Professor Jodhka?
Nothing much. I think many good ideas have come, and I think through those we can perhaps, you know, keep thinking about Gail some more and kind of, you know, keep the book open. And I think there's a lot of material in Gail which needs to be worked on. Scholars like Gail are not born every other day. She is not just a scholar. She has lots of lessons for all of us in many different ways. And I think we need to kind of engage with Gail and study Gail also, rather than just kind of, you know, pass judgments about what she said or what she did not say. And I think that's why I'm saying it's an open book, and I think there are lots of different interpretations of Gail would be possible in future. Feminists would have their own Gail. Dalit activists would have their own Gail. Somebody like me, who is a professional sociologist, I would have my own Gail in my own way. And I think those options should be kept open. I think that's what Gail would have also wanted us to do. So I think that's the strength of Gail's memory. And that's why I think she's being talked so much about in kind of social media, and I think we should try and kind of work with that spirit. Thank you very much.
We have Dr. Nagmani Rao, who has been Gail's comrade in the same political group she belongs, and they have worked together till the end of her life. Nagmani has been with Gail. They are both family, extended family of Gail, and I would like Professor Nagmani Rao to give her perspective on Gail's.
Actually, we can't
see you fully. You'll have to, I think, position your screen.
Okay. Just a minute. Yeah. 1 second.
Now it's fine.
Yeah. Actually, I haven't really come to speak about Gail today. I'm not mentally prepared. I'm still kind of grieving. Mm-hmm. It's been almost exactly a week. She passed away last Tuesday. And it's not easy to talk about her in the past tense, even though we know the end was coming. But I think as a person who's part of the extended family of Gail, who has worked very closely with her in the movement in Sangli, and I put that in the chat box when I think Professor Gunawarthy spoke about her. There's something about Gail which was at once complex and simple. You know, she had a simplicity about her, but her thought process was very complex. And to really grapple with both these sides of Gail as a comrade was not always easy. And I think as we worked together, we really understood each other at a personal level as well as at a political level. We had our political debates, but one of the things I'd like to share about Gail at a very personal level is she was a good, at least 15, 20 years older than me. I've turned 65, she was 80, so 15 years older. And yet, despite this, whenever I put forth issues strongly, she never had this attitude of putting me down. You know, it's your perspective. I may not agree with you. And she would, of course, we'd argue things out a lot, particularly when the whole Shetkari Sangatna and Chandwad, she was extremely, you know, enamored about the large gatherings. And I felt that local mass organizing is very important before you can be part of large networks. So there, even in terms of mobilization and organizing strategy, we did have differences. I wouldn't say it's a difference of opinion, but a difference of approach, because she felt I was, you know, too stuck on local mobilization. And I said, we are too early into our movement to get into very large. It was the Parityakta movement which really took us across Maharashtra, and the Parityakta movement was in one sense pioneered by Sri Mukti Sanghash, because right when it was formally established in 1985, and we used to have these shibis and meetings in the villages, which led us to actually carry out a door-to-door survey in some of our base villages, where we found a very, very high percentage of single, we initially used the word deserted women, which is what the reality was, but none of us liked that word. You know, abandoned, deserted women were things which we as feminists were very uncomfortable about using. And it was Gail and Indutai who coined the word parityakta in the movement, even if it had a sort of a Sanskritized kind of a sound to it, but they felt this speaks much more than, you know, talking about them as abandoned or deserted. And it was during this kind of thing that we really began to see the intersectionalities that Gail was talking about, you know, of class, caste, and patriarchy coming together in juxtaposition. And even when it came to organizing the Parityakta women, at one level, they organized at Parityakta, but we could also see the divisions along caste, class, and patriarchy. The Maratha women were a little less willing, although they were far more oppressed than the Dalit Bahujan women, to come to the forefront of mobilization, whereas the Dalit and Bahujan women were there on the streets. And we had a few Maratha women joining us. So here we could see how difficult it was to forge that unity across class and caste. And when we were struggling with these local struggles, when she went to Chandwad and saw a whole lot of peasant women organizing, she, Chetna Gala and others were extremely impressed and felt that this is something that we feminists have been clamoring for so many years. And yet we have not been able to. So there's something in Shetkari Sangatna. And I had my reservations because I didn't like the tone of Chandwad's Shidori, you know, which denigrated all that we had done in the autonomous women's movement since the mid-70s. So we had these debates, discussions, but the point I'm making is whether it was related to writing. Another argument we often had was this whole thing of, you know, in the feminist movement, we believed in non-structuredness. And so Gail gives me this paper on the oppression of non-structuredness. She said that it's better to know the structure and the hierarchies and address them than have this kind of a hierarchy which is somewhere in the background, but nobody is ready to confront it. So, you know, we had very, very interesting. And I would say that as we went along towards the last years, of course, with her deteriorated health, my relationship changed in a very different way. There was a new tenderness in our relationship. And I would have to keep telling her, I love you more than I love Bharat, because I always made it a point to, she had a real sweet tooth. And so if she was coming, the larger portion of the sweet dish had to be for her and not anybody else. So there was a different kind of, and she was very happy with that. So there's a different kind of a family relationship which evolves. I begin as a fan of a writer, a scholar, when I read We'll Smash This Prison as a young feminist. I meet her some years down the line, and then we become comrades and we become family. So it's kind of been a journey. I also, you know, it's like ghar ki murgi dal barabar. There are so many writings of Gail. Being such a prolific writer, I have not read a lot of what she has written. I always extracted when I needed to write something but she never said, look, I've written this and you should read this. I've discovered Gail's writing out of my own need. And that's another aspect. She's so secure about what she wanted. and convinced about what she did, that she was never into any kind of competitive politics. And I think that's another very important facet, and that made her non-sectarian. That made her very non-sectarian. So yeah, these are, it's kind of disorganized what I'm saying. These are snippets of memories which are kind of flitting back and forth. And I guess I'll just stop here and say with this thing that I would like to rediscover Gail now through as many of her writings as I can read. Thank you very much.
You brought the nostalgia back and our collective catharsis also in the women's movement back. And I think that last photograph, black and white photograph, which I had taken in 1981 conference, and you know that, as you said, that anything she never talked about, we knew her only as a fellow activist. It was only when we entered academics in the late 80s that we realized that we started reading her seriously, but otherwise it was basically our street fighting days. We all were together, and you know that in the after the Mathura rape case and the nationwide anti-rape movement, when we organized the first conference on perspective of women's movement in India, at that time we were expecting some 82, maximum 200 delegates, but more than 400 delegates came. Earlier it was going to be focusing only on rape, but then the delegates also demanded that we should have sub theme on health and violence and law, and then we have how to organize. So much of problems of logistics we had, but anything that was assigned to Gail, she would do. I just requested Gail, will you write minutes for your subgroup on women and violence, and she readily agreed. No, so this is the experience of ours, and I think she introduced us to so many new ideas without me knowing that she's without even forcing or pressurizing anyone. No, so that was a very important lesson that we learned from Gail's life. And the way she interacted with the fellow activists. Aruna Burte, another early feminist of Mumbai, she has nicely written in the chat box that for, and she has quoted Dhammapada, that for never in this world do hatred cease by hatred. By freedom from hatred they cease. This is the eternal Dhamma. And I think that's what Gail, because I never saw Gail talking ill about anybody. She may differ ideologically, she may discuss truth and nail, but I never asked, she discussed ideas, no? So that was very important. She would often quote in her public lectures in Marathi as well as in English, that without Jyotiba Phule's famous quotation, without education, wisdom was lost. Without wisdom, morals were lost. Without morals, development was lost. Without development, wealth was lost. Without wealth, Shudras were ruined, and so much has happened through lack of education. And I think that's what the education, not only in the formal sense, because even they organized the Jail Bharo, School Bharo Andolan, you know, in Dhule, when the Shramik Shangathna had organized, we all had supported that why Adivasi children were kept out of formal schooling. So the education is a very important this thing. And the way she has quoted so many folk songs and revolutionary songs and Sri Mukti songs, which were written in Bilori and Marathi, she translated them, and she is very, even when she's discussing the dense political ideas, she would intersperse them with this songs and verses with new acknowledgement. And I think Shripad Submissive's verses, where he says that the sun of self-respect has burst into a flame, let it burn up the caste system. I think that with that I would end, because that is what very sharply Gail puts it in several of her speeches as well as writings. I thank Dr. Arjun Kumar for providing this platform, Dr. Bharat Patankar, Professor Manisha Desai, Dr. Surinder Jodhka, Professor Arvind Arsari, Professor R. Indira, Dr. Ajay Gurgudavarti, Dr. Uma Khan, Mahima Kapoor, and also Prachi Patankar, and also IMPRI team for making this panel discussion and the memorial meeting very, very important, both in terms of it touched our heart and it also touched our mind. And I think this is a very historic event. And I request Dr. Arjun Kumar and IMPRI team to take over.
Me over to you for the vote of thanks.
Thank you so much. And it was such an enlightening discussion, and to remember Dr. Gail Omvedt and her contributions to the literature. And also for this wonderful session, I would like to thank on behalf of IMPRI Center for Human Dignity and Development, our wonderful speakers and distinguished panelists for the day, Professor, mostly Dr. Bharat Patankar, Professor Manisha Desai, Professor Surinder Jodhka, Professor Arvinder Ansari, Professor R. Indira, Dr. Ajay Gudavarti, Dr. Umakant, and also Dr. Nagmani Rao, for your wonderful views and sharing your sharing Dr. Gail Omvedt's life with all of us, and also the participants who joined in large numbers, and for sharing your views and comments and passionate responses over the chat box. It was truly heartening. And most of all, our moderator for the session, Professor Vibhuti Patel, thank you so much for being the guiding light for this wonderful session. This is really good, getting down into the history as one of the best events. And also may Dr. Gail Omvedt's family and followers accept our deepest condolences on behalf of IMPRI. We really feel and hope that her legacy carries forward. Thank you so much, and Team IMPRI, I am really grateful. Thank you so much, and I wish all of you a very good evening. Take care.